not close to mangroves. But obviously not everyone has the luxury to do that. But as I say, if you can actually sort of drive that change by eating fish lower down the food web, like sardines and even your mackerel is, you know, it could potentially change that. But I mean, to change like things like the poultry industry and all, it's going to require more than just our personal, you know, everyday turning off the light switches, you know. So it's going to require something more than that.
So where do you buy fish?
No, so I get my fish from a range of people, and sometimes I sort of resort to the market as well. But a lot of my fishermen are Pomburpa, Ekoshi, that area, you know, just off Saloy.
But doesn't it go a bit deeper and call for a rethinking of economics? Because in terms of economics, Goa has done beautifully well. I mean, look at the fish catches, look at the kind of GDP growth that has happened. But in terms of environment, it's a disaster.
No, but in terms of both. Now, fishers are sort of facing the brunt. My uncle owned two purse seiners in the south, and he's out of it. He's saying, you know, I'd never get into that. Most trawler owners don't want to send their people. But what I agree with you is that we have to move from this high volume, low quality fishing. Trawling is, in an essence, is low quality fishing. The fish is not necessarily fresh. It's all like packed in the end, except for your shrimp, which go to the export markets, and we are always failing export standards. You know. Trawling we have to move from this high volume, low quality to a high quality fishery, you know, wherein, you know, which is sort of more just in a way as well. And that's what the aim is generally, because if you look at it, trawling is not really, you know, fishing for you and me, it's fishing for lots of other things, you know, and lots of other purposes. And in fact, that's what's keeping it going for now, you know. There is on every coast. So it just doesn't coincide with ours. So on April 15th to July 15th is the East Coast ban. And because it's supposed to coincide with the breeding period of fish, which it not necessarily does. You have like 500 odd species there. So some species for the prawns, maybe they're breeding around that time, but not many of the others. Many of them breed in the monsoons, but it did coincide with the monsoon periods, you know. So the East Coast gets a bit of the south of the southwest as well as the northeast. A bad hit of the northeast, but the ban is not in the... at that point of the year, and it's along the East Coast, all states, but it's not uniform like it's on the West Coast. So on the West Coast, Kerala, Karnataka, Goa, Maharashtra follow the same ban, which is great, you know, because otherwise the Goa trawlers are complaining about the guys from Karnataka, but the Goa trawlers are also going to Dapoli, Harne, and, you know, fishing for bombil. So if you see bombil on our fish landing sites, they're never caught in Goa waters, because bombil start off a place called Ladgar and they move upwards. You know, you don't get them south of that. So if you're catching bombil, if you're catching some of the karangids, you will not get them south of that. You know, so you're catching them from anywhere else.
So is it true that the problem is so serious that in some parts like Somalia, the pirates actually feel that they are protecting their shores from you know, outside fishermen?
Yeah, see, the thing about the Somali piracy thing is also not completely true. It's like a lot of those people who went into piracy were basically agro-pastoralists, and they were herders. They took their goats and they basically ate goats. So fisheries developed there around the 1970s. That Puntland region, which is known for the which is the known piracy region, it's not Somalia, it's Puntland. It's a long stretch along the east coast, and the north is also not doing that. But those pirates are purely in it for piracy. There's a whole thing published called the Freakonomics of Piracy, basically, by a guy called Jai Bahadur, who's he's Canadian. And he's written this book, and what he's saying is that the Somali pirates never really suffered a fish crunch. That's why they became pirates. They just saw this as an opportunity. And what happens is people learn from these opportunities. Like now apparently piracy is on the increase in Nigeria and the Gulf of Guinea. These guys are just roving the Gulf of Guinea like the Somalis were doing, and the Somali piracy is actually on a decline now. So it's increasing on the other side. So things happen, like the Malacca piracy is on a decline as well. But on the West Africa, the piracy has really gone up. So it's not because of fish. Fish declines were not the major driver, but it could be. Like lots of our Indian trawlers are now fishing in Sri Lankan waters. Not just a good proportion of them are fishing in Sri Lankan waters. So I remember when I was on a fishing boat, I was always really scared when I was in the Gulf of Manaar, because you would inevitably venture into that area, because when the war was happening, you know, when the crisis was on, there was pretty much no fishing in that region. So that area actually, you know, was doing well at that point of time, just like World War II had on cod stocks. It was a temporary closure. So cod population just shot through the roof, and then they went crazy and they managed to collapse it a bit. Mm. You know, so
there's no danger of any fish becoming extinct.
No, I'm not saying there's no danger. That we have not recorded any extinctions.
What happens is that there are some endemic species.
Correct.
And they're in the rivers. And if the river gets highly polluted, like God gets, now here is the chromium and all kinds of dangers and other things, they're dumping all the poison there. And are they not in danger of being extinct? And also, they forever care about this thing. Like Japanese and Chinese have what is known as shark fin. So they will catch entire shark, cut the fins, and then throw them away. And because of that, actually, the entire shark population, certain species of shark, completely at the point of extinction. And they have been banned, but in spite of that, illegally they do the shark fishing.
Yeah, so to answer your first question with regards to pollution, and there's been lots of extinctions locally. So lots of species have just gone off. Like if you go to some parts of Canada, which the rivers were thriving with sturgeon, they're gone. Many rivers along the east coast of India, which had huge populations of hilsa in Tamil Nadu, it was not just revered in, you know, in West Bengal and in the Sindh. It was also in many parts of the east coast, not so much along the west coast. We have something called the Toli Shad here. Okay, so lots of local extinctions have happened, but it's overall the population still persists. Okay, so you still have fish. Okay, so there's been no local extinctions recorded. But as you're saying, many shark species, many sharks have been wiped out from areas. Okay, that's true. But in India, even though we land a lot of sharks, we don't necessarily fin. We eat every part of the shark. We use the liver for oil. And that's a good part. So when people talk about shark finning and you see all these pictures, we don't do that. We eat everything. And in fact, we'll happily eat all the bycatch as well. But it's not being given to us. Okay? So.
But are we exporting shark fin?
Yeah. No, okay, we shouldn't be, but I'm saying hypothetically, you know, if we, yeah.
Are we exporting shark fin?
We used to, but it's kind of on a decline because, you know what, the shark industry itself is no longer cost effective. You had, in Goa, you had like about 4 or 5 big boats in Betul that would exclusively go for shark. Now they had to diversify to drift nets because you've got to go too far for sharks. In Thuthur, in Tamil Nadu, there's a little village. These guys have gone as far as Perth and, you know, been caught there. They've just, you know, circled. They go down to Chagos. They go everywhere. You know, they're just roving. And the thing is, they're exclusively shark fishermen. And what they used to do in the good old day, you know, this bendi, this beech tree, which has got these people leaves, they used to chop an entire tree, put it down, allow for small fish to come. It is an aggregating device of sorts. And then big fish would circle it. And then they'll just put a long line with many hooks, and they would pick up stuff from there. So, you know, you had a whole range of things, and not just that, with some of these fish going off, lots of the culture, lots of the knowledge is also vanishing with that, and that's the scary part, you know. So, like, you know, there's one thing that we suffer in fisheries a lot is something called the shifting baseline syndrome, and it's also true with forests and other ecosystems, wherein if you ask your grandfather what is the biggest shark he caught, they say, wow, when I was young, we caught a shark that was minimum 5 meters. And if you ask my dad, what is the biggest shark he caught? And he says, oh, when I was young, it was amazing. The biggest shark I caught was 2.5 meters. And then you ask me, what is the biggest shark? I say, oh, wow, it is amazing. When I was young, I caught a shark that was 1.5 meters. And you see what's happened? We don't even have that, you know, that amnesia. It's kind of an intergenerational amnesia that we've just lost that information. Our forests have shrunk. So, you know, for many people coming from outside into Goa, they think it's a wonderful place. But for me, it's actually really great.
LED fishing, that is a very controversial one. Can it be selective? A particular fish prefers a particular color. Mm-hmm. And by that, can it selectively catch?
So, yeah, that's a very good question you brought up. I'll tell you why. See, as I said before, fishers will modify and they'll keep doing things to remain afloat, to stay profitable. So now, LED fishing comes at a time when the situation is really bad. They want to stay in fishing, so they have to keep profits going. So they add a new dimension. What LED fishing does is it puts your it lights up the sea near rocky areas where trawlers can't go, and attracts fish out of that. And then you can put your net and catch all those fish in that area. So it's bad, but we have come to this condition where we will do anything to remain afloat. So when they talk about ban LED fishing, yes, ban, but you've got to do many other things as well, you know. And the answer, as Gabriela brought up, I mean, we have to look at to aquaculture as the next, as the future, you know, because, and we've got to do it in a right manner, basically. with the polyculture system going, you know, and you know, something that is healthy as well.
So they use two different colors, I think, green and blue. Now, is there any difference? The blue catches attracts a particular
fish. I actually don't know. I'm not sure. But yeah, you can use. I mean, LED lights are used for things like squid. If you go like to Thailand, Burma, you'll see the entire fish, the entire sea lit up like, you know, like some you know, sometime in Christmas or something like that. It's just lit up everywhere for squid. They call squid jigs. They just put their nets down and they lift the whole thing up. You know? And they have these trawls.
Sorry. Can you talk a little bit about prawn fisheries and just kind of the difference, like the quantity of fish that we get from fisheries versus the open sea?
You mean the like, shrimp trawl?
Yeah.
Yeah. So like, yeah, for shrimp, for every kilo of like prawns you got along the coast of Goa, you had about you had approximately, I think at that point of time it was about 15 to 20 kilos of other stuff for prawns. Huh? Oh, okay, okay. Was that the question?
Oh, yeah, the farm.
Oh, right. So, basically, I cannot tell you the exact stat, but globally, aquaculture contributes to about 40% of the seafood in the world, 42%, of which 36% comes from China. Okay, but China also has a reputation of skewing its statistics, where the rest of the world had already reached the maximum sustainable yield and was going down that way. China was still, you know, going up. And yeah, the question was, is China growing? But the thing is, a couple of things happened. They were like, you know, going to other seas, but also it was, you know, skewing of statistics at that point of time. But it is true that aquaculture right now contributes to a good amount of the shrimp that we eat. So I said 42% globally. I'm not really sure in India, actually. I don't have the statistic off the top of my head.
So the bassa we get in India, aquaculture fish from India, or does it come from
us? It's come mainly from Thailand, Vietnam, grown in the most appalling conditions. And the sad part about the whole thing is that we've got an Indian basa, it's called pangas. If you go to the north, the Gangetic Plain, we've got this delicious fatty basa called the pangas. It's really delicious. But we instead import basa at a very cheap rate because of the price. And they're starting to grow basa. In fact, not just basa. We got piranhas now, we've got tilapia, you know, tilapia's been there. You know, piranha, if you go to the market, they'll tell you like, you know, a cheap pomfret, they actually sell it as pomfret. And in Bengal, they call it rupchon, you know, which is this beautiful, it's a paku fish, basically. It's an omnivore, it's got these big teeth. And yeah.
But Aaron, in few other fields, the point comes out so strongly that economics doesn't make good environmental sense. In fisheries, this point comes out very strongly. Whenever we've spoken about, say, you know, producing our own fish, it has always been with profits in mind. It's never been with local requirements. Although trawling was supposed to have helped the protein inputs of the locals.
I'm not really sure of that, especially the earlier days of trawling never really...
No, it was supposed to, on paper. It never did. So when it came to aquaculture, I mean, that was for export. And, you know, like I remember Mr. Baijal, who's now the chief the LG of Delhi, telling us very openly that, I mean, who can afford these dollar prices of your prawns? You know, it's so many dollars per kilo or something. That it's obviously for export. So never has need been taken, you know, kept as at any point in the equation.
Yeah, it's very surprising that in India, Bangladesh, you know, which have such, you know, such large coastlines, wherein, you know, a fair significant proportion of population, like I think over a quarter of our population lives along the coast and is dependent on fish in some way or the other. Okay, many of them are, you know, are micronutrient deficient. They're like, you know, there's a whole range of problems. Many of them don't even get the fish. Like if you're on a trawler, you could eat whatever other fish you wanted, the bycatch, but they would never cook the prawns for you. And I always said, you know, can you cook some of those prawns? And they said, no, we can't. It's like our blood going, you know. They would never cook the prawns for you.
But Aaron, you just said the fish that's lower down in the food chain is better for you.
Yeah. No, I mean, if you, on the boat. Yeah, I want to eat everything.
And the talk is called prawn curry rice after all.
No, but even if you have to ask for a couple, yeah, anyway, but we can talk about that.
Because
Oh, the chickens? No, these are massive factory farms. The chickens are cramped there.
Yeah, but is the chicken not suffering from it like the mad cow?
Yeah, they're suffering.
No, we also suffer.
Yeah, I think they're suffering as well.
I don't eat the chicken, but I eat the egg.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. I mean, there's a big problem with the poultry industry. And you're not able to get, if you're looking for healthy chickens, it's difficult. Unless you probably have them in your backyard.
No, so we stopped the chicken.
Yeah.
But I haven't stopped eggs.
Yeah.
Which at least you can get dirty eggs sometimes.
That's
but
true.
But shouldn't the general population be informed about this? We are non-knowledgeable that what our chickens are eating and we are eating it.
Yeah. But
there
see,
is no information. It should be disseminated.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, there is information out there, but as you're saying, it's not well spread out for sure. Yeah, I agree.
But fisheries is not a mainstream issue which is widely discussed in academia and things like that.
It is. I mean, fisheries is actually a very old and well-developed tradition, but as you say, it's like purely sort of, you've always looked at, and the profits, and it's profit-driven.
Yeah.
So the fisheries sector or the universities that taught fisheries were purely for fisheries management point of view. You had something called the maximum sustainable yield, which was the maximum amount of fish that you could take beyond which the resource would be overexploited. But that was a bit scary, because if you have a mixed species fishery where you have prawns and a whole range of other things, the prawns will just rebound back again. The sardines will just rebound. But your sharks and rays would have already been wiped out from there. Like, at one point of time, I used to see loads of these electric rays in Goa. I don't see them anymore. I've not seen them in years. But along the East Coast, you still see some. But I remember I was cutting open these electric rays, large numbers of them, and they had like 3 or 4 pups, So that was the reason why. They took ages to grow, to reach that size. And before you knew it, they were taken, So, but also, it's not just looking at aquaculture, but also if you look at the US, which is a heavy consumer, they have managed to, restore some of their fisheries, especially along the West Coast. Some of their fisheries are actually doing well again. In Newfoundland, the cod stock has come up that they are going to open the fishery again. So you have these success stories. I mean, marine conservation is full of these sort of doom and gloom, but you do have these success stories, and they have to be flagged, because, we should not reach a time where we don't have fish,
Goa.
What is your message? For us, who can do a little bit somewhere, what is that message for us?
So one thing is if you have the luxury of, getting to know your fish, that's one thing, and getting to know the fishermen, who live around you, I think that's the first big step. Even within the restaurant, you never know when you're being fooled. And there are tons of these imposters in the market. They'll tell you kalandar, but they're selling you tilapia. And if you go to Kerala now, you ask for curry mean, and you're getting tilapia, you're not getting your real curry mean, which is Atropolis. So very often. So lots of these things are happening. And but to answer your question, the thing is, it is difficult, because, it's a choice you need to make all the time. And but you've got to be conscious of it, just like your vegetables, just like the chicken she's talking about. I think that consciousness got to develop, and we can't just look at the sea purely as something that provides for us. It's good that it provides for us, and we have that association. And I think what trawling also does, besides besides destroying the ecology and all that, it provides for food, it's increased the GDP. But what it also does is it takes the person out of his environment in a way. Before, we had to go like to the Manos, and we knew exactly which are the sluice gates. We knew exactly how the fish was caught. It was caught every spring tide, And there was a relationship with your food. And I think having the relationship with the food is one of the first things that you could do. You know what I'm saying? I think we've kind of lost that. And I just want
to
show.
No,
you can't, obviously. But I'm saying if she, understanding is the first major thing. Exactly. So as I was saying, eating low down on the food web could be one easy solution. Then trying to elevate the rights of small fishermen, really through policy, because, over time they're just small organized groups, but they have never really been given that, and evaluate them on a series of criteria, which also look at, other fisheries. So it's a whole scale of grey now, and we have to look at it. Your rampon car also will catch a whole range of, really small juveniles. Besides that, there is also things like, there's a whole range of solutions. Okay, now with the internet, we are well connected. Farah was talking about, eating stuff higher up on the food web would definitely have an impact. but actually thinking about that every time, there's a whole range of things that goes into sustainability. Like some of the fish require a very small mesh size, even though they may be sustainable to consume, you've killed a whole number of things around you. So if you know, like for example, that you can go to your backyard person and buy the stuff, then you should do it, and you should support those kind of guys, you know. And lots of these areas, like in Britona and Aldona and all that, they're getting lots of estuarine fisheries. And in fact, Goa's estuarine fisheries are among the better ones. You know, our rivers are not dammed, you know. So we still have a free flow. We support a lot of estuarine communities over there, okay. And they catch a whole diversity of species. Obviously, for the restaurants, it's definitely not going to suffice. But you know, in a way, I look at Goa as a place that where is one of the few places where we get to eat the seafood that is caught in trawlers. Most other states, they never even get to see the seafood, you know. Like big squids around in Tamil Nadu, you get this huge park bay squid. It's called Septututhis, you know. It's this huge thing. You'll never ever see it in the market. It just gets exported, you know. And that's sad because the local population never see it, you know. So I think it's, and I think that is, you know, I mean, that has to do with awareness, you know, what you're catching in your surrounds, and, you know, being clued into those things. And there are a whole bunch of, you know, a whole bunch of other small things that you can do, which I can actually, if you send me your email, I can actually share with you.
Aaron, one small suggestion and a small question, briefly. I think that, you know, a group, we need some kind of network among people who discuss, who are concerned about fisheries, because so far the fishermen have been doing it from a trade union point of view.
Yeah.
But this is environment and this is sustainability, which is all another dimension. And the question is, you know, how realistic are the statistics of the Goa government fish catches over the years, which are nicely growing?
Yeah, actually, it's growing for many reasons, and it's not really growing because last 2 years, sardine catches, which never decline normally, they're always going up, because sardine is a pelagic fishery, and as you remove the top predators, you tend to have species like sardines and other species lower down in the food web. But last 3 years, we've had a consistent drop in sardine catches. So much so, in 2015, it went down by 50%, which is huge. It's impacted the whole country's statistic. Because to have sardines going down is really scary. And what we've had recently, every year, there's been a jellyfish bloom. You know, people keep asking me, what is a jellyfish bloom? I said, it's happening every year. But this year, there's been two consecutive ones, you know. And it's been weird because we've had lots of species come inshore, you know.
Yeah.
Like, we had lots of the jinga prawn I was telling you about, which is what we call solar over here, were in the Shapura estuary. We don't know why. Gabriela sent me some pictures of some morays that had come inshore. I went there and I actually saw those morays, like, you know, on their side. And what happened at that point of time, water temperatures was really low, and it apparently led to some sort of flux where the lower oxygenated waters came up and actually caused this movement. But nobody really, there's nothing, there's no sort of finger on that yet.
This was recent, right?
Very recent.
A couple of weeks ago.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It happened a couple of weeks ago, but the bloom happened like twice, a huge bloom, you know. And there were blue bottles in the south, there was other stuff in the north, but there were these massive blooms, like in Morji, it was covered with them. Sorry.
Yeah, I noticed one thing. I went kayaking in the estuary in Shapura, and I realized that there are all these new toilets being built along the shore, which is probably part of the question. But we just have a pipe going straight into the river.
Which shack was it?
Isn't pollution connected
to the river? Yeah. So the sea, you know, I'm just talking about fishing here, but there are tons of other confounding variables. There's pollution, there's all kinds of stuff. I mean, all the plastic litter that goes into the sea, basically, you know, even though it takes like hundreds of years to degrade, it degrades at a very, very slow rate, you know. And what you have is these little microplastics that because of because of nature's forces, they shape themselves very similar to plankton. And they're fed upon by fish that are slightly up. And that basically gets back on your plate, you know, with a whole range of other things. So besides that, so pollution is one of them, definitely. And organic pollution is a huge thing. If you go to Thane Creek, you have 20 million tons of solid waste, which has killed an entire, fishing community there that has been fishing for centuries. In that creek, you know, there were Moors and Arab dhows that would go right up the creek to the Ullas River. Now the Ullas River is choked, you know, and you have the mangroves. You have a big patch of mangroves, but it's monospecific because there's no fresh water, you know. So it's very scary what's happening there. So you lost diversity, you've lost the communities that have moved out, and they've gone out. And then there is no real reason for you to help it because it's in your backyard, you don't know what's happening there, you don't buy fish from there anymore, so why should you bother to preserve it? Can I just show you all one last slide with, you know, before I end, if there aren't any other questions?
One more question. trawling is one. What is the other fishing called? Is there
purse seining.
Yeah, so the purse seining is for stuff like the shoaling fish, like sardines, mackerels. So now basically that's been criticized heavily because it's a bulk fishing method. You can pick up tons. But the answer to that is also, yeah, it is definitely impacting, but it's not hitting your bottom habitat. Number one, they visually spot a sardine shoal shimmering at the on the pelagic waters, and they go to it and then they surround it. Okay, and then they've got these weights at the bottom. It forms a little purse, and then you pull it up. So you can catch large catfish, these big sea catfish, sardines, sometimes kingfish, sometimes black pomfret. A whole range of species you can do by purse seining. It happens only over a couple of months, but it's a bulk fishing method. Then you have the gill nets, you know, which are these long nets that are kept straight. And the fish push themselves through the net and get their gills caught in. And then you have many, there are many other gear, you know, I mean, there's a whole range of gear, but this is in the mechanized sector, these are the three main types.
But trawling by itself has impacted the whole
fish. It's not by itself, so all these things are together, and I'm not even saying that the small scale fisherman is not doing any harm. By the sheer numbers of people that you have, there are too many fishermen chasing too few fish, this is the problem, you know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
We get something in the market called crab sticks. There's no crab in it, it's a low-grade fish, which actually they remove the bones and then process it and then put a flavor of crab and it gives the smell of crab and people can be easily deceived.
The whole Suriname industry.
They themselves say that there's no crab in it. So instead of discarding or giving it as chicken feed in the poultry, this can be also processed for human feeding.
Yeah, but that's another sad thing because this is all reduction fisheries. You don't know what you're eating. You could probably be eating a chicken leg as well, you know, and you wouldn't know because it's just sort of pulped meat that is available in these sticks and it's flavored with whatever. And a lot of it actually is a trash fish. In Vietnam and all that, what they do is they have these huge drums where they keep trash fish and whatever they consume, they throw it into their pot. But the rest is just kept in this hot sun and they're chucking salt in and it's decomposing and it just oozes this and that's how you get a fish sauce after a while. So the Thai fish sauce and nampla is from better than that. No, but I mean the Italians knew it by us. No, the Italians had a much more sophisticated name for the same thing. It was called Colatura di Alisi, which is this, you know, this again fish sauce produced by an identical method using intestines of this one sardine. So it was produced using intestines. And I'll just show you one thing that I've been involved with. So as a part of, you know, this awareness raising program, as you're talking about, is trying to bring some of the diversity back into people's diet. So I've been working with a few chefs. And the idea over here is it's difficult to track sustainability because there are many, many variables that go into sustainability. Especially Indian fisheries, where over 90% are unmanaged. So we don't really know what's in our sea. We know our biomass, you know, total biomass estimates, but we don't know. So I've been working with these chefs, and lots of these fish that we see, you know, that are generally discarded, I meet these fishermen and I say, yeah, because a lot of them are used as crab bait or, you know, are chucked over, but they're used as crab bait or the traditional fishermen in the estuary use it for some reason or the other. Now, this fish is called the spiny flathead. You know, it's a little ugly looking creature that lives on the bottom and it predates on other fish. It's just a sit and wait predator that just sits around there and it lunges whenever there's a fish. So this is a chef from Maracas, but I've also been working with two other places. And we decided let's try this flathead because the flesh was really nice and firm, you know, and it didn't have too many bones. So you just got to cut off along the flanks and you can actually eat the cheeks because they're like nice big cheeks, you know, which are very meaty. And stuff that would go for crab bait, you know, I mean, you can get these lovely fillets out of it. And in many parts of the world, they are eaten. And, you know, we tried this with, you know, eel that was being used as crab bait and lots of stuff that was, you know, not being used. But the thing is getting this into, and lots of local communities ate this in any case, you know, it's not something new I'm doing. People in Goa have eaten a whole range of things, and not just in Goa, but in other states. But, you know, you get something like this, you know, lovely herb-crusted flathead fillet with tartar and, you know, summer salad. So this is, I mean, I don't have the other pictures, but you know,